due to the nature of this program, listener aggression is advised.
Hey, I'm Carla.
I'm Heidi.
And we're the Butcher Babies.
This is Charlie Sheen.
Yo, what's up? This is AJ from Fire from the Gods.
This is Rich Ward, the Duke of Metal from Fozzy.
Saddam Leader from In Search of Sun.
This is Beefcake the Mighty from Guar.
And Bustulus Maximus.
Ahoy, this is Chris from Maelstrom.
Yo, what's up? This is J-Dog from Hollywood Undead.
Hi, this is Ash Costello from New Year's Day.
This is Tommy Vex from the Bad Wolves.
This is Joe from Dead.
One last brutality.
And I tell you now to say fucking metal, yeah.
Hey, this is Fran Strine, director of Hired Gun, and you're listening to Honest Brutality.
I mean, everybody in my band's an A-list player. I just don't have time for B-list guys.
I always dreamed of being in a band. You know, I want to be part of a band. I still want to be part of a band.
Hired Gun is... he's like the best of the best. Everybody knows that this guy is an assassin. And nobody will know who he is, but he gets the gig because he's the best available musician that gets hired to go on tour to deliver that music for that artist.
You are the guy that Billy Joel chose to help make those hit records and those unforgettable tours. That's who you are.
And if you're not great tonight, you may lose your gig tomorrow.
I'm walking out there. I'm going, you got 25 feet to save your career. What am I going to do? I've just seen two guys get fired, and I got fired from the last record. I turn around, I sit down, I go, ding, something pops into my head.
Pink's looking for a guitar player, man. And he's like, would you be interested? I was like, hell yes, I'd be interested. Because I wanted it so bad. And I just had a feeling about everybody in that room. They had me walk outside, hang out for a few minutes, and they brought me back in. They're like, get the gig, man. We'll see you in a week in Budapest. I was so happy. So happy.
Justin's amazing.
While some members of the Ozzy Osbourne band slept in their tour bus parked next to the house.
Boom. This huge boom out of the middle of nowhere. I mean, looked out and there's our tour manager on his knees crying, they're gone, they're gone. It was an emotional challenge for all of us. To get up on that stage, you know, and it was the same production, same clothes, same intro of Randy playing Diary of a Madman right before we went on, you know. The only reason why I left the band was because it was incredibly painful, beyond words, to continue, to carry on, to be on that same stage where Randy should be, but wasn't there anymore.
You know, I remember seeing Kiss being on the front row, like just standing on a chair, leaning on the stage right in front of Ace, and I still remember hitting his platform boots. At the end of the day, we all can still remember that kid in us that saw some band on TV or on stage that said, I want to do that. I think it's really important. You got to keep that alive inside of you. You got to keep the fan in you always there, always alive. When I see little kids down the front, I always go, yeah, that was me. I was one of them kids.
For years, I've been like, I don't want to be a side guy anymore. But how the f*** do you say no to Bon Jovi?
When you're a kid, you're like, I want to be a rock star. I want to be a rock star. I never said that. I always said, I want to be a session guy.
I'll never be as great as I want to be, but I am willing to spend the rest of my life trying to be as great as I can be.
What I always say is, if you do something that nobody else does and you do it fairly well, you have a chance.
Well, there comes a point when the realization sets in that they're going to be done with me someday. And when they are, I got to get out before that happens.
I might not be the star, but I'm having an amazing time playing drums, touring the world, making money, and supporting other people.
Getting to the top is hard. Staying at the top is virtually impossible.
Hey everybody, it's Honest Brutality. This is the show that is all things rock, metal, and stuff that doesn't suck. I'm your host, Evil, and I am joined by my co-hosts.
This is Big Sloppy.
Hey guys, it's Camera Rebel.
We have a very special guest on the line, which we are prone to do. We bring special guests on all the time. But this one is really kind of a big deal for me. I'm excited to have this gentleman on with us. He is the man behind Hired Gun. Now, if you haven't seen this movie, you need to see this movie. This is probably the most rock, metal, cool-ass movie I've seen in a long, long time. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Fran Strine. You there, Fran?
Good morning, guys. How are you?
Hello. Wonderful.
Fantastic, sir.
Great. Yeah, thanks for having me on.
Thank you for doing this. We really appreciate it.
We'll see if you thank us when we're done.
Yeah, right.
So, Fran, you and I have been chatting a little bit prior to this, but let's just get right into the whole reason that we kind of hooked up in the first place. Was you were talking about Hired Gun, and I had seen it on my feed in social media, and I had commented on it, and we started kind of bantering back and forth. You're still out there working this thing and promoting it.
Oh, yeah. No, it's you know, it was a long year promoting the film, and once it hit the Netflix platform, it even blew up a little bit bigger for me. So it's been a wild past month since it hit. I think December 1st is when it launched on there, and it started trending immediately, and you know, it was in the most popular feed or whatnot. So we felt really, really fortunate and lucky that the people gravitated towards the film and really got the message and enjoyed it. You know, that's all you can hope for as a filmmaker. Yeah.
Right. Let's talk a little bit about who you are, Fran. I mean, you've got a laundry list of different things you've done working with, and it looks like mostly in the music community, from Slipknot, yeah. Aaron Lewis, Stained, Nickelback, Seether.
You know, I started off my career about close to 30 years ago as a photographer by accident, and wound up really fortunate to be able to shoot for some of my favorite magazines I used to read growing up, like Metal Edge and Hit Parader and even Rolling Stone.
Nice.
And then went from that into doing advertising photography for Ibanez and you know, Gibson, PV, all this stuff. That's where the real bread is when you're a working photographer. You know, these magazines don't really pay that much, but the advertising angle does.
Right.
And I started growing a little bit weary and tired of just shooting photos. And, you know, some of my heroes that were photographers, like, you know, Ross Halfen and Neil Zoslauer, did all these tours with, like, Van Halen and the Scorpions and whatnot. So I managed to get myself on a tour as the tour photographer on a tour back in 99 or 2000 called Tattoo the Earth. That had Slipknot, Seven Dust, all these bands that I'd worked with for years. And never did video in my life, but I happened to bring just a Sony Handycam just for my personal use, just to, you know, capture memories or not, you know, my first tour. And fell in love with it. I was just like, wow, man, this is really cool. Now I got moving pictures and I can actually just tell a story instead of just a shot,
yeah.
You know?
Nice.
And that's where my love of filmmaking and then documentaries bloomed, I guess.
Nice.
Wow. And, you know, I think the first thing I did really where I got paid, Evan Doss, because I've known those guys, you know, for Clint was even in the band, Clint Lowry. They were called, I think it was Crawl Space. Yeah, so they got signed and bring their record in Atlanta with Butch Walker. And they had me come in with my little handy cam, and one of their A&R guys was there. And I was like, oh, you do music video stuff? I'm like, yeah. I kind of bullshit my way around it. And he's like, well, we want to do a full-on DVD that accompanies the record of the making of this album.
Wow.
Are you available? I'm like, yeah, absolutely. You know, I had no idea what I was. I didn't even know, to be honest with you, I didn't even have a computer back then. I was still shooting film, you know, as far as camera stuff goes. Wow. I didn't even know how to use it, how to edit any of that stuff. So I kind of fudged my way through that and
Fake it till you make it.
The DVD was, yeah, so, and it was successful. You know, everybody loved it. It was funny, and those guys provided me with so much good material. And then the next thing you know, they're doing this acoustic show, you know, where they're taking around the country just doing acoustic Seven Dust. And they asked me if I wanted to do their live DVD. You know, this is like a 20 camera multi, you know, angle deal. And again, never have done anything like that before. I'm like, sure, I'll do it. You know, you just have to make it happen. And like you said, you do have to bullshit your way through it sometimes.
Right.
<you know?
laughs> Right. Right.
You know, from there, it just kind of snowballed. Everything's word of mouth. And just like a hired gun, you know, the most important thing is being cool on the road and having great etiquette while you're out there, not being an asshole and getting kicked off the tour. So from that, it led me work, you know, a great career with the band Stained for about 8 years, not only touring with them, but doing all their in-studio stuff. So I would go up and live at Aaron Lewis's place for about 7 or 8 months while they wrote and recorded. And, tour those guys around the world, Nickelback, same thing, Seether, Dolly Parton, ironically, a lot for her album photography and video work. So, yeah, I've been really lucky.
That's absolutely amazing. And I totally am on board with you because I also do concert photography. I've never done the videography
right.
part of it, but I absolutely love it. It's one of my passions.
Huge yeah, it's passion. Fun, right?
Oh,
just
my
kinda
God.
I get down there and try to figure out each guy's move and what they're going to do next.
Oh,
and
yeah. It's an adrenaline rush.
Yeah, it can be. Yeah, I remember my biggest rush was when Kiss did their first reunion tour with the originals coming back.
Oh, yeah.
You know, Ace Frehley in 1995, I think.
So
I did 2 weeks of that tour as their tour photographer. And I remember being in the photo pit the first show. I think it was in Atlanta or Chattanooga. I can't remember. Somewhere in the South, but they open up with Detroit Rock City, and they're coming down from the rafters on the platform. I'm weeping like a 2-year-old kid, man. Just like, I can't even see what I'm shooting. I'm like, these pictures are gonna suck.
Oh my
you
God.
Know, so yeah, and I still get that way. Like when I, you know, was photographing, you know, even Dolly. I'm not a country fan at all, but Dolly Parton's such an iconic legend.
Right.
That you know, she requested me last year, actually, where we did the world premiere of Hired Gun at South by Southwest. And she called me, you know, saw a Nashville number and picked it up, and it was her and her manager, you know, asked me if I was available to do her new album cover. You just don't ever recover from a phone call like that, you know what I mean? It's like,
that's wow. Amazing.
Okay, yeah, when do I need to be there, you know? And Thursday, I'm like, I line it up, I'm in, you know?
Nice.
And she's such a pleasure to work with, you know. She actually, you know, she's a work dog, man. She, the first day we shot a lot of the outdoor material, and then the next day she likes to do one giant photo shoot and do like 30 wardrobe changes, and that'll be it for the year. She won't do another photo shoot. So when Cosmopolitan or, you know, Southern Living or whatever needs a photo of Dolly Parton, she's always had, she has one with a different outfit every time. So
wow, that's
smart.
For her to get all dolled up and everything like that. But anyway, she, you know, we always played music. We had like a little jukebox going or whatever, and she put on this leather outfit, man, and we're cranking out Judas Priest, and she's up there dancing the Priest, and they're just like, this is awesome.
Oh my
are
gosh.
You fucking so, kidding
yeah.
me?
Oh my
that's
God.
Amazing.
That is the most ridiculously cool story.
Yeah, no, she's rad. You know, the craziest thing is the first time I photographed her, she asked me if she could shave my head, and I'm like, yeah. Fuck yeah, you can shave my head. So yeah, so I got a clean shave from Dolly, and it was part of the music video.
Wait a minute.
That's just crazy.
I did not expect that. So you're telling me that Dolly Parton shaved your head?
Yeah, so it was the first time, like I did a live DVD with her in London at the O2 Arena. We filmed 2 nights there. It was incredible. And she caught wind that I was also a photographer, and she had her manager call, and you know, we worked out the details, and I showed up, and there was a film crew there, so it kind of caught me off guard. I'm like, what are all these people doing here? And she's like, well, we're filming behind-the-scenes stuff for a music video I'm doing. I'm like, oh, cool. So, you know, they're just filming, us taking pictures or whatnot, looking over her shoulder. And that's when she asked me, she goes, would you let me shave your head for a scene in the film? I'm like, yeah, without hesitation. Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. You don't ever turn that down.
Yeah, right.
So she had her, she had her PA go out and get a, you know, Barbasol and a Vic razor, man. She came back and she shaved my head. It made the music video. I think it's called, the video is called Change It. I think. Oh, yeah. So God.
That's amazing.
It's in there. You can hear, you can hear me mouth fuck is going on around here because I couldn't believe it. Yeah.
The big question,
really, really cool.
The big question there, Fran, is when she was done shaving your head, did you tip her?
Oh man. Yeah. I tipped her by giving her a discount on this photo shoot. She managed to beat me up on that one. So.
I'm surprised she could get close enough to shave his head without bumping into him. <With that. laughs> Oh my God. That is, that's amazing.
Yeah. That's great.
Yeah.
Thank
she's
you
so
for
down
that.
To earth. I got to tell you, with all the metal stuff I've ever done and rock and, you know, cool people I've met, she's definitely probably the one that stands out the most to me.
You're not the first to say that, man. Yeah. I've actually heard that from other people that have said the same exact thing. Uh-huh. When she comes into a room, she lights it up, and she treats you like she's known you forever. I've heard that from several people.
Yeah, I mean, there's certain bands that I've worked with that's just not pleasant. It's not fun because they're just griping or they just take everything for granted. And just like, you mean I got to play for an hour?
Yeah.
You got all day long to fuck around.
At the beginning of the conversation, you had said that you became a photographer sort of by accident. Is there a story there you'd like to share?
Yeah, it's ironic. You know, it didn't even dawn on me that I would ever get into this business. I have no formal training, no schooling in photography or filmmaking, but I used to just sneak my camera. Well, I mean camera, I mean like a full-blown, like a Minolta X700 with a big lens and everything in the shows. And this was in the late 80s, early 90s when it was illegal to bring your camera
super
in. Like,
taboo.
On your ticket, no cameras.
Yeah,
you know?
Right, yeah.
And they would throw you out if they found one. But I would sneak my camera, not to take pictures for anything other than memories, you know. So Alice Cooper and the Scorpions and, you know, Megadeth, Metallica. And after a while, my friends were like, man, you really have an eye for photography. And, you know, people just tell you that even with an iPhone camera. Like, oh, man, you're awesome. You know, to all their friends or whatnot. But I never took any, you know, thing serious out of it until I sat down and started analyzing the pictures. I'm like, you know what? Out of every 10 shots, I get a really good one. This, you know, composition's right. The lighting's right. I'm getting the shot that I need. And there's not a microphone in the guy's face.
Right.
So I was like, let me see what I can do with this. So I started sending I made a book, like $5 or $6, and sent them to all the publishers that I'd mentioned earlier.
Right.
And every one of them would, you know, either write a letter or whatnot. We don't need any more freelance photographers. We have enough. Thanks, you know. So, and I didn't give a shit because that's not what I was angling to do anyway. I just let me just see what happens. Until I got Metal Edge magazine. Whoever is at their front office screwed up and gave me the editor's home address. And
perfect.
The book went to her home, and she dug the pictures, man. And the next thing I know, I get a what was called a picture purchase voucher for a photo that she was going to buy from my book.
Wow.
And that's how it kind of started, you know. And the next thing I know, she's like, hey, can you go shoot Pantera in Atlanta? Because that's where I was living at the time. And I was like, yeah, can you go shoot Jackal or ZZ Top or, you know. And the next thing you know, it's like, I could always tell her favorite bands because anytime they came through town, she'd be, it was Typo Negative and Slaughter for whatever reason.
And, that's an odd combo.
You know, yeah, it was a weird combo, but you know what? Both those bands were great. I'm not a fan of Slaughter at all. I love their music, but super cool guys. Typo Negative, I like some of their stuff, but Peter Steele was like one of the coolest guys to shoot because he didn't give a shit. You know, he's like, here, literally one day we're shooting a pool hall. You know, doing a setup shot, and he just takes the 8-ball and jams it in his mouth, you know, or he'll devour an apple because he's got these fangs or whatever. So he'd play for the camera and like give a shit, you know, instead of griping about it. Because I can't tell you how many guys just gripe about, you know, having to get their picture taken. So that's kind of where it started, you know, and the rest is like I told you, just wanted to get on a tour, did that, brought a video camera. And that's where my love for filmmaking developed.
Yeah, and you know what? That's one of the hardest things about photographing, doing portraits is that those gripes actually come through the photo. You know, if they're not having fun with it, you can totally see it in the picture. And that can screw up a whole photo shoot.
Oh, yeah. I remember Slipknot once. You know, there's 9 guys in that band.
Yeah.
And there's a venue in the South called The Masquerade. It's not there anymore. They've tore this building down. But they had this cage because it was like a rave dance club at night, you know, after hours. But the cage probably holds like 3 people. All 9 guys stuffed into this thing. And I think it's in it was a big cover. Yeah, it was a cover shot too for either Kerrang or Metal Hammer, or one of those over in the UK.
I think I remember seeing that picture actually.
Yeah, man. Yeah. It was a trip for sure. But you know, those guys always love playing for the camera and don't give any, they want you to be quick, but they don't really freak out on you, you know. And I've had a great working relationship with that band since day one. I was the first photographer ever to get them published in a magazine.
Wow.
It was Mick Thompson, the guitar player, and he and I remain good friends still. And it was a cover shot for Metal Hammer when they tried to publication here in the States, and it failed, unfortunately, after 2 years. So, but nonetheless, man, it was a great shoot. And like, it's just about developing friendships with these artists, you know, and having them trust you and not being a don't do drugs. I don't really drink. I have a glass of wine now here or there since I moved to the Bay Area. But yeah, it's pretty cool.
You should go to Vegas or something more often. You're a pretty lucky guy. Like, it seems like the luck is with you.
Yeah.
Not that you're not talented. Don't get me wrong.
You know what? That's funny you say that. When I was staying, you know, Aaron would bring me out for his solo tours and we'd play Mandalay Bay or whatever. And I love playing roulette. So I just threw down one chip and was like $7,000 I won. $5. I was just like, okay, this is cool. Yeah. Wish you could be more lucky in other areas of my life. But, you know, yeah, it was
that's awesome.
It was pretty cool.
Take it where you can get it, brother.
Yeah, yeah.
So that brings us full circle here. So you're out there, you're doing these tours, you're taking the pictures, you decide to start doing videos. What was the thought process? What was the catalyst behind making this film?
Okay. I talked to you about doing pleasant tours and unpleasant tours. Well, an unpleasant tour was what I did with Five Finger Death Punch. I had,
go figure.
Yeah, there's no secret. You know, everybody knows about Ivan's, you know, substance, alcohol abuse or whatnot.
What are you talking about?
Nothing but the best.
Really? Is that a thing? What? Oh, wow.
Yeah. So at the time, I'd moved from Atlanta to this beautiful area in the Bay, Marin County, in a little town called San Rafael.
Very familiar.
It's really, really beautiful area here. And a lot of musicians, which we'll talk about in a bit, so I'll tell you who lives here and who I ran into a few times, which blew my mind. But I was out with Five Finger. I kind of semi was going to take the summer off. I just done a giant tour. I was staying to Godsmack, and I think Shinedown was on that run, 58 cities or something like that.
Oh, shit.
I was just like, you know what? I'm going to take the summer, the spring and summer off and just enjoy the fruits of my labor and just kind of chill. And Zoltan is one of the guitar players of Five Finger. Sent me an email. I've never met him before. I don't know how he got my number, but he was like, hey, man, we're desperately searching for a video guy to come out on tour with us. Would you be interested in doing the Mayhem tour and beyond? And I politely declined. I'm like, look, I'm burnt out. I need to take some time off. I'm just going to relax. He goes, okay, understood. And I guess they were continuing to look for guys and couldn't find anybody. And a couple of weeks later, he sent me another email. I'm really having a hard time. We really need somebody to come out for a social media angle. And there's any more. So, you know, they get it as far as that goes, keeping their fans engaged.
Mm-hmm.
And I politely declined again. I'm like, you know, I'm sorry. Maybe I can help you find somebody because I know a few people. And I guess those people were booked back up and they threw a number at me. You know, in the last email, he's like, I'll give you this much per week plus this per diem if you just come out for the summer. And it was a number I couldn't ignore. So I was just like, you know what? I'd be a fool not to take this because, you know, for 8 weeks of work, it's, you know, 52 weeks of pay almost. So I was like, yes, I'll come out.
I'll take the winter off.
While we did that, it started off as a world tour. So we were started in Tokyo and worked around the rim, you know, down through New Zealand, Australia. And by the time we got to Singapore, Ivan had lost his mind a couple times and got arrested on a flight in Australia and, like, freaked out in the elevator with me on it with his chick. And I'm like, I got to get out of this situation.
Yeah.
So I was sitting on a bus, you know, in Singapore. It was like, what am I going to do? I got to get out of this and figure out what I'm going to do. I don't want to tour anymore because it sounds like a lot of fun, and it can be. And I'm grateful for all the things I've gotten to see and do. However, it does rot your soul after a while.
Yeah.
You know, you know, after 20 years. So, you know, I knew if I was going to jump into filmmaking, I had to up my game and really do something compelling and with a great story, you know, because to me, Hired Gun is about music and musicians or whatnot. But to me, the music is almost in the background.
Yeah.
It's about the guy's stories, right?
Yeah.
So
totally.
I knew immediately when I, you know, is Rudy, you know, is he the best bass player on the planet? Probably not, you know. But Rudy Sarnes as a person and a character is somebody that everybody falls in love with.
Absolutely.
And I can attest to that because, yeah, so I took this movie around the planet and it's the same reaction in every scene, every time, you know, people cry in certain parts or cheer or laugh. So that was my goal in setting out making the film. And that's where the desire to make it was I was on that bus and, Singapore, and I knew the you know, Jason Hook was a partner in the film.
Right.
Yeah, right.
Pretty much more or less only to gather some talent because we, you know, between the both of us, we know a lot of musicians.
Right.
You know, other than that, he kind of just stayed out of the way. So I hit the ground running. So as I landed back in the States, you know, a week later, I was on a flight to Los Angeles to start conducting interviews, and one of the first ones was Rudy, and I knew immediately that he would be a main character in the film because he's just the person he is. And, you know, I mean, look at his career. He leapfrogged from one big band to the next to the next.
It's amazing.
It is amazing. Yeah. I actually sat down and watched the documentary with my 15-year-old daughter who absolutely loves rock and metal. And we were sitting there and it was like halfway through, I'm like, are you like not falling in love with this guy? Like he gives like the most warm fuzzies and it's like, you just feel like you've known him forever. He's just so warm and open. Pretty amazing.
He's been so supportive of the film. I mean, he still tweets about it. And,
yeah.
You know, he's come to a lot of the film festivals with us and it's just his pleasure, you know?
Yeah. He gets around. My very first concert, I saw Ozzy, and Rudy Sarzo was the bass player there back in...
Oh, yeah, I saw that, too.
It was the first concert on the Diary of a Madman tour, and I didn't know who he was at the time, obviously. And then he went from there.
Right.
Think about it. He went from there to Quiet Riot when they blew up. He was with Whitesnake. Hell, I saw him just a couple of years ago playing bass for Blue Oyster Cult in a little club in San Francisco.
Now he's playing with... who's it with now? The Guess Who.
Oh, I did not know that. Yeah. Burt Cummings even with that band anymore?
I mean, I don't know, but he's killing one of those guys right now. So he's having a blast.
What a trip. Yeah. When I watched this movie, it made me think about the movie The Wrecking Crew. Are you familiar with that one?
Oh, yeah.
Because it's very similar in that you're reaching out to different musicians that are behind the scenes a lot of the time that don't get the recognition. And you don't really understand that a whole lot as a casual fan. You don't really catch a lot of this. And I think you did a really good job, much the way they did in that movie, at capturing the people behind the scenes and seeing what they have
the
to
real
go through.
People.
Yeah. And what goes into making an album, what goes into a tour, some of the lack of respect a lot of these people get.
Oh,
and to see what has happened and the way some of these guys get treated is bullshit, and to expose some of that as well was really well done.
Laid bare.
Yeah. And I really enjoyed that aspect of you're very honest in your picture.
Yeah. Well, that's what I wanted to do is like complete transparency and give everybody a chance to speak. Now, that being said, you know, two people really stand out as negative in the film are Richard Patrick and Billy Joel.
Right.
And I did reach out to Billy Joel, you know, I was able to acquire his email address through some certain channels, and I sent him an email. I was like, hey, man, we're doing this documentary. There's some, you know, some comments made in this film that you might want to rebuke. So, would you be interested in doing an interview? And he's like, yeah, I'd be interested. Can you send me some transcripts and scenes? And of course, I'm like, oh, God, man, because it's not good, you know?
Right.
I'm like, yeah, I'll send you. So, you know, I was like, you know what? I got to be fair. And if I'm doing my job as a director and a filmmaker, I've got to be completely transparent and, like, going into this thing neutral. What if these guys are just bullshitting me? So I sent everything over to Billy. And then he had his attorneys respond with, you know, Billy's going to decline at this time. And we ask that you remove everything out of that movie regarding Billy Joel.
Wow.
Which he can't do. I mean, legally, there's nothing he can do about that.
Oh, fuck that.
So I reached out. Yeah. So, you know, I was like, you know, thank you for responding. You know, not going to take anything out of the film. This is why I'm asking Billy if he would like to go on the record and clear the air, you know, and same response back. So, you know, and look, the only angle that I could really see, not to just throw him completely under the bus, that was honest, was that the guy got ripped off and his bandmates are asking him for more money while this guy's broke and these guys are still getting paid. And that would piss anybody. It'd piss me off, you know. And it pissed Billy off, it seems like, and that's why he did what he did. Yeah.
You know, the proof is in the response. The proof that the claims are true is in the response from the lawyers, in my opinion, in hearing your story. I mean, the proof that they're not making this up, that this is all very genuine, is right there laid out.
Yeah, and then the other person was Richard Patrick.
Oh, boy.
Who has, and I don't think he saw the film until it came on Netflix. So that was the first time I heard from him. He sent me a text.
Uh-oh. What do you say?
He goes, oh, man. He said, Phil Buckman looks really petty, and you maybe look like a goddamn idiot or something. I don't know, something crazy, like really bad.
Well, those were his words.
Exactly. That's what I told him, too. I was like, you know what? I was like, the way I look at it, you're just being brutally honest with your guys, you know?
Yeah.
You're telling them up front, look, don't expect anything besides get on stage and kicking ass. Because I'm going to take all the money home. And those, you told those guys up front, if anything, Phil Buckman may be the guy that, you know, wasn't so smart in his business negotiations. But, you know, there's stories flying everywhere. But he had asked me if I'd put the entire hour and a half interview that we did with him on YouTube. And I'm not in control of that. So I'm like, you know, I can't speak to that. So,
yeah. Wow. Yeah. Well, you know, on all of these topics, I just wanted to interject that when we started this, you know, we named it Honest Brutality, and we really wanted to go down that road with being transparent and kind of doing what you did. This film really spoke to me in that regard because it has inspired me to stay true to what we're trying to do.
Absolutely.
When we started this thing, you know, get to the bottom of it, lay it open. Take a look at it. And we don't always do a great job at that. We really try. But right. You know, I really admire you, sir. My hat's off. I think this is one of the greatest rock films, music films, documentaries in general that I've seen in a very, very long time. I'm 110% behind this film.
Yep, same.
It's right up there with Decline of...
Western Civilization.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's right up there with that, man.
I think it's better, personally, but yeah.
It's in the same...
Oh, thank you, man.
I think you have the same... the same reach with this as we had in that one.
Well, I appreciate that. It was a lot of work.
I bet. It looked like it.
Yeah, it was almost two and a half years of for the same. And, you know, a lot of people don't know where it goes into these. They think you just go out and film it, grab a bunch of music, an archival photo. Man, I got to tell you, every song has to be cleared with the publisher and the record label, and you got to pay for it, negotiate the fee, and... Then there's the archival footage, which was an eye-opener for me because I didn't know how expensive it was. So some of that stuff, just to give people an idea, some of that stuff was $350 a second. Oh,
Jesus criminy.
What the funk?
Yeah, man.
Wow.
It's really, really, really expensive to make a movie, even a documentary. You know, you're talking about a whole crew of people. And to me also, since it is a music film, even though I said previously that it's more about the story, but there is some wonderful music in the movie and all these live jams and stuff.
Those live jams are amazing.
Oh, I love them.
Those are badass, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I was lucky enough, man, to get 19 of the cast guys together over a weekend at East West Studios.
Man, you had fucking Kenny Aronoff.
Kenny Aronoff's a beast, and he's a big supporter of the film, too, man. He
I'm a drummer. So that guy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that guy's one of the dudes that I always looked up to growing up. Like, mm-hmm. God damn, he's got chops. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so
he's all right.
Yeah, whatever.
Not only that, he's probably the hardest. He and Jason Newsted are the two hardest working people I've ever been around in my life. Yeah, Kenny's just a workhorse.
Jason Newsted set me off guard a little bit. Cracked me up because he's got the baseball cap and the way he talks and his mannerisms. He remind me of the villain in that that Sam Jackson plays.
Oh, in the Kingsman?
Yeah. Like, I was cracking up. He's a character.
Yeah, let me tell you something, man. He did that one album called Metal. Just Jason Newsted Metal.
Yeah, a few years back,
maybe mm-hmm. 2 or 3 years ago. Well, he brought me in to do the same thing, one of the making of documentaries and a bunch of the podcast or the webcast stuff or whatnot. And super, super cool guy. Knows all the business angles. And he's like, I've never seen anybody work as hard as him. You know, the only other person I think that works hard as him or like cares is probably Mike Mushock and Kenny Aronoff. Like, if those guys, those three dudes formed a band. Well, Mushock was in Newsted.
Oh, yeah.
But,
yeah,
man, those three guys together, it would just be like a workathon. Cause... And even, let me tell you what, Mushock works hard, but even he told me, he goes, man, do we really need to rehearse for 12 hours, 5 days a week? You know, because he had to relocate out here to the Bay Area over to Walnut Creek.
Oh, shit. And, I grew up in that area, man.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, so you know what surprised me when I moved here to San Rafael? I only moved here because it's just beautiful, you know?
Right. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I came out here to a commercial shoot once. I'm like, wow, this place is like one of the most beautiful places I've ever been to in America, you know?
Oh, yeah. North Bay up there, you're around.
Yeah.
Well, hell, there's a reason you get Skywalker Studios and shit up there.
It's
just gorgeous.
Yeah. So I go to Petco one day, right here off 4th Street in San Rafael, and I walk in, there's James Hetfield with his puppy. I'm like, what the hell is James Hetfield? I had no idea they were from here.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and then next thing I know, I go to this place called the California Film Institute. You know, it's a movie theater, but it's like, you have to have a membership or whatever to get in. But anyway, Lars Ulrich is a huge independent film buff, and I'd see him at every screening. You know, we catch up and chat or whatnot. Super cool guy.
Yeah, oh, that's neat.
Neil Sean from Journey, man. I see him. Everybody up here drives eco cars or whatnot, Teslas, and, you know what? He's got 4 Lamborghinis that he whizzes up and down 4th Street on. I'm like, holy shit, you know. We interviewed him for the movie too, but he didn't make it. Unfortunately, we interviewed 65 people.
You have a laundry list of artists that are amazing. Yeah. I mean, from people that caught me off guard, like, you know, Ray Parker.
Let me tell you something. Let me just stop you right there. Ray Parker Jr., hands down, and, you know, we all love metal and rock or whatnot, but I had Steve Lukather and David Foster both tell me that Ray Parker Jr. is the greatest living guitarist alive.
Hmm. Okay.
Like the way he plays, rhythm just so clean. And we're not talking metal chops. We're talking jazz or R&B. Played on Stevie Wonder's Talking Buck record on Superstitious and all those great songs.
Right.
And nobody knows. They just think Ghostbusters, but they don't know.
Yeah.
That he came from, well, not only a hired gun, but when he was, there's a movie out there called Detroit about the riots in 1967.
Yeah. Just came out, yeah.
And Ray Parker lived on that street where those riots happened, and he would get his ass kicked by the cops.
Wow.
You know, at 13, 14 years old. So the reason he is where he is today is because he, instead of getting his ass kicked by the cops, he stayed in the house and learned to play guitar, and at 14, ran away from home and played with the Spinners. As one of the backup guitar players, you know.
Right.
Then he came back, and people were like, well, who's this prodigy guitar player? I want him to play on my record. So next thing you know, he's playing on all of Marvin Gaye's records and Smokey Robinson or the Funk Brothers. And Stevie Wonder discovered him and brought him to L.A., and that's when he played on, you know, his debut album and subsequently a tour with the Rolling Stones in 1972, you know. And then he became a session guitar player and played on everybody's records and broke out as a solo star himself, which is Ray Parker Jr. with, you know, that song, The Other Woman, and which is pretty rock and solid, I guess, for him.
Yeah, right. He seemed like a really genuine dude in the film. Like, it was just really cool.
Let me tell you something. He has gone around. He went to Australia with me to promote the movie. We screened it for the Grammy voters. So he went to Nashville, Chicago, San Francisco, L.A. He went to South by Southwest. He just loves to travel and loves music and loves the movie. So, been a huge supporter, man. It's been really cool hanging out with that guy. And he's cool as hell. You know what I mean? He's just a cool dude that you just like to hang out with. I mean, I'm going to back up 1 second. I went off on that tangent because you mentioned Ray Parker, but, you know, I was telling you the music was always in the background, but it's an important component because of all the live jams and the music of the film. So I was like, I had opportunities to mix it anywhere I wanted to in L.A., you know. But I live literally 2 exits from Skywalker Ranch. Right. So I just took a shot. There's nobody to get a hold of there. There's just an email address called info@Skywalker Ranch. That's it. So I just wrote a little email saying, hey, I'm a local Bay Area filmmaker. I got this little movie. Looking to mix it. If I don't have to go to L.A., that'd be great because I'm in the area. And for anybody that knows filmmaker film mixing, there's no other facility in the world that is as good or better than Skywalker Ranch.
Right.
And I got an email back saying, hey, do you have anything we can look at? So we just finished our trailer for it. So I sent it over, and immediately within 10 minutes, I got an email back from John Knoll, who's the director there. It was like, we have to mix this movie. Can we send you a bid? Usually the first question anybody asks is like, what is your budget? You know,
yeah.
How much do you have to spend? So they sent us a bid, man. I got to tell you, it was about $15,000 cheaper than anybody else in LA would have done it for.
Wow.
Nice.
And you didn't have to travel.
Yeah. No, I didn't, man. And you know, the first thing everyone was, well, what's Skywalker Ranch like? You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Is it cool? I was just like, I can't even put it into words. I just tell everybody, it's like, whatever you think it's like, that's what it's like, because it's that cool, you know?
Right.
Yeah, so I got to spend 2 weeks there, and, you know, they have cottages on site where, you know, people can stay, so you just roll out of bed and go there. So Even though I live here, I was just like, I got to take the opportunity to just stay at these cabins.
Hell yeah. So, yeah. Right.
Stay there, and it was great. And I got to tell you, man, Scott Lewis was our sound mixer, and he did Inception, Super 8.
Yeah.
All of House of Cards. He's got a couple of Emmys from that. He just did the new David Fincher series on Netflix as well, Mindhunter. Just a great mixer, super cool guy.
Wow, so what an amazing
movie. Yeah, so I would tell all the viewers there, if you're going to watch this movie, watch it loud because it was mixed for that.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
And here's a little unknown because a lot of people don't really pay attention to it, but the, you know, everybody hears all the famous songs from like Kiss and Alice Cooper, but you know, there's also an original score to the movie that I was able to get the Crystal Method to do. So it's all original music. Who knew that they did scores? But they did, you know, they do Bones, House, Fast and Furious 7, they did some stuff on.
Oh, wow.
And their agent, you know, while I was looking for composers, their agent was like, have you thought about Crystal Method, like the EDM band? No, I haven't. You know, that would be the last person I would think of, actually.
Right.
I didn't even know they did
right.
that stuff.
Yeah, kind of out of left
field. Come to find out, so Scott Kennedy is a huge Quiet Riot fan, the Crystal Method guy. Huh. It was like, man, he goes, let me just cut the Randy Rhoads death scene where, you know, Rhodey's all emotional. He goes, let me cut that. If you like that, we can work everything out, because I really want to do this film. So I sent it to a man, and a couple of days later, sent it back. It was crazy. And also in the Jason Newsted scene where he's crying on the newspaper story, mm-hmm. when Cliff dies, that is Justin Chancellor playing bass for Tool.
Hmm.
He came in and did that for us. Yeah, because you know, Scott was like, well, who am I going to get to play bass? Because I don't play bass. I play machines, you know? So he's good friends with Justin from the band Tool, and he brought him in and was like, you think you could write something over this? And yeah, wow, Justin jumped at the chance because Cliff was like his idol. You know, I wake up every day, man, saying, I mean, it's been a long road, but I still, you know, I think about the people involved in the film, not only the cast and the musicians, but my crew, how hard they worked. I'm just super lucky. And then David Foster told me something early on, you know, that resonated with his career. He's like, always surround yourself with people better than you, because it's going to make you look that much better. Yeah, so,
right.
You know, I'm able, like, I really wanted to edit the movie at first, and I'm like, you know what? I'm not the right guy to edit this thing, because I've lived with this together. I tried to for about a month. It's just like looking at white noise, you know, because you've lived with it for so long. I was not able to tell the story the way I wanted to. So you got to be able to, like, take your ego and just shove it all the way to the side, do what's best for the movie. And it would have been a nightmare and not a very good film if I were to edit it. So, you know, I learned my boundaries and, you know, trusted my team, and they delivered.
So, Fran, what is your most memorable moment in the making of Hired Gun?
Probably the Rudy Randy Rhodes story, because, you know, we interviewed Rudy twice. The first time he kind of glossed over and didn't really talk about that at all. You know, he's like, he just went into, like, after Randy's death, I needed to get out of that band.
Right.
And that was it. He didn't tell us the whole story.
Right.
So when I knew that he would be a central focal point in the movie, I'm like, you know what? I got to get that story done, because it's such a pivotal shift in his career. So had that not happened, would he ever been in Reformed Choir, right? Became so successful, or joined Whitesnake or Dio. So I just called him like, hey man, this is, you know, this is a touchy subject. I want to respect it and tell the story with respect. But, you know, you didn't really talk about what transitioned you from leaving the Aussie band.
Right.
You know, what kind of an impact that had on you as a player and as a person. I feel like it's really important to bridge that gap, and we don't have that gap. And I want to really make you a focal point in the movie. And he agreed to it, so we went down. We only filmed that one scene. You know, what you see is what we shot. And I got to tell you, not only myself, but the crew were just like weeping in the corner afterwards, and so was Rudy. I mean, it was like a cathartic, crazy experience for him to like go that deep into it.
Right.
And that's what you see on his face is real, you know?
Yeah.
That was cool. You know what? I really enjoyed interviewing Jason Newsted, because you saw how intense he was in that interview.
Yeah.
He sat in that chair for 3 hours and was on 12 the whole time.
Really?
Yeah. And, and unfortunately, you know, that stuff is, you know, in the movie, you can't show 2 hours of everybody's interview. But, I mean, I was nervous. I was just like, oh, my God, I need to smoke a joint after this. Like, Jesus Christ.
Relax.
And, you know, Neil Sean was really cool, too, man, because, you know, here's a kid who used to sneak out at 14, 15 years old and go play these blues clubs in the city. And his parents had no idea. I mean, he was just sneaking out and jamming with like Eric Clapton and Santana. You know, so he had so many cool stories, man. But unfortunately, it wasn't the right fit for this movie.
Right.
And he was pissed off that he didn't make the movie, by the way.
I spent all that time and I'm on the cutting room floor, you bastard.
Well, a lot of the press started coming out for the film. His name wasn't anywhere attached to it. And he sent me a text at 7 o'clock in the morning. I'll never forget it, last year. He's like, hey, man, I'm seeing all this press and stuff about the movie, and I don't see my name anywhere, and I get axed. And I heard the ping go off, and I look at the phone, and I'm like, Jesus Christ, 7 a.m.? He's bugging me about this right now. So I was kind of laying there a little nervous, like, I got to respond to the guy. You know, he was the first person to ask me why I didn't make the movie either, so I wanted to be delicate about it.
Right.
And before I could, 10 minutes later, he called. Phone's ringing, and it's him. And I was just like, you know what? Fuck it. I'll pick it up. Like, hey, Neil. Hey, man. What's the deal? So I just tossed. It's like, I'm just going to be honest with you. I was like, we interviewed 65 people. Only about 30 made the movie, even if it's just for a brief second, you know. And it wasn't because your story's not good. It is. You know, I respect you. You're a legendary guitarist. You know, your work speaks for itself, blah, blah, blah. However, your story just wasn't right for them. It's the truth. You know, his story was not, just there wasn't a lot he could add to the story to make it move.
You went all Richard Patrick on him.
Yeah. You know what? I get it. You know what? I think he sees himself now. It's like, oh man, did I really say that? And that's why, you know, we were talking about that earlier. Like, well, if there's anything you want me to cut out, I will.
Right.
But I'm thinking, sometimes, you know, some of these guys got really, really comfortable because I know their lingo because I've toured, I've been in the studio. Right. So,
yeah.
We can jive, talking back and forth, having these conversations like we are now. And sometimes, you know, we'd wrap up and my camera guy was like, man, I bet you wish you didn't say that. You know? Good thing we got an interview release for him.
Right.
So after the dust settles on Hired Gun, do you think that you're going to make a part two or take another adventure in a different documentary?
You know, I did a television pilot, which I can't really talk about because it's being shopped right now. You know, Hired Gun did really well outside of Netflix, but when the Netflix thing hit, the phones just did not stop ringing from, you know,
right.
I can imagine.
Studios, agencies, yeah. or whatnot. Yeah, so myself and my agent are going to Sundance tomorrow to hold meetings with a bunch of people with all kind of possibilities, none that I can share right now.
Yeah.
But they are music related and pretty big. You know, I'm super excited about the opportunities and the
cool
and what's to come. So yeah, it's just a little nervous because now I got to follow up something better than Hired Gun.
Right. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
That's a huge benchmark.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, and I'm really proud of Hired Gun, man. I mean, look, it's.
I was going to ask you about that. That's like that killer smash debut album. Like, how? Well, shit.
Yeah.
You know, how do you follow it up?
Well, you know what? It's all about finding the right stories and the right characters. Just like it was not easy to find all these characters for Hired. Like Jay Graydon and Liberty DeVito. All that. Who knew that they were going to be these characters? Sometimes you have to interview all those people to find the characters. You know?
Hey, let me ask you a question here regarding making a documentary like this. Because I've had an idea for a documentary for a long time. I'm going to keep that to myself in case I ever want to follow through with it. To do a documentary like you did here.
Yeah.
What kind of number should I start with as a budget to be able to do a decent documentary?
That's such a hard question to answer only because, you know, is there a lot of music involved? Is there going to be a lot of archival involved? Or is it just going to be talking heads? Because, you know, there's a lot of documentaries out there just talking heads. And by that, it's just somebody sitting in a chair telling their story.
Right.
So if you're talking one with, you know, and if you wanted to, how good do you want it to look, you know, or you want to shoot it on the.
So in other words, if I wanted to do a decent one, and the one I have in mind is going to involve music, you know, copyrighted music and old interviews and things of that nature, very much along the lines of what you did.
Okay.
So a ballpark, just to start, where should I look at a starting point for a budget?
Okay, like minimum, like if you just use a little bit of music and, you know, anywhere, I'd say anywhere from, and this is just a ballpark. Mm-hmm. 700,000 to a million.
I was thinking 1.5 was kind of where I was at, but okay.
Well, there's tricks to the trade too. Like some of that music, like people heard some Billy Joel music in there, real quick.
Yeah,
is what was called the fair use.
Fair use. We're very familiar with fair use.
We know all about that.
Yeah.
So you know, you have to have an attorney,
right?
Sign off for it and get, you know, you have to have insurance and all this other shit. That's just the horrible part of filmmaking is all the other stuff you got to deal with. Like,
all
can we use
shit.
This, you know? I mean, there was, I bet you we saved, I don't know, $400,000 or $500,000 just on fair use. Otherwise we'd never be able to use any of that stuff.
Right.
But Michael Jackson, you think Michael Jackson's going to give us his music?
Right.
You know, and you're just using enough to get the point across to the viewer of what you're talking about.
Yeah. Typically under 30 seconds, right? Something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you can make a great documentary for 700. And look, when I say that number, I just throw it out there. It's terrifying. You know, and I had a lot of money to play with making this movie, but I took every penny into account and knew how important it was to stretch that penny. You know, not only for myself to make the best movie I could, but also, you know, to the investor who invested in the film. You know, it's they stuck their neck out on the line. So
yeah, we've got about $700. So I think
hey,
we got a good start.
Can I borrow that handy cam that you were taking into contracts initially?
Yeah, right. So we shot this. You know, a while back, I put away some money, and I was I still own a house in Atlanta. You know, the housing in Atlanta is not crazy expensive, so I had a choice. I could either go buy this red camera, this is cinema camera. They film like all the Star Wars. It's a badass camera.
Right.
Shoots a 5K and whatnot. Or pay off my house in Atlanta. And I decided to go with the camera. That's what we use for Hired Gun. You know what I mean? So that saved us.
Well, I see, if
we had to rent that camera for all those interviews, we're talking, you know, with the package, probably $1,200 a day.
Oh, wow.
Right,
yeah,
right, yeah. Makes sense.
Yeah, so, but, you know, it was a huge loss financially for me because it was so much money, but I didn't have to go to a rental. I mean, just think about having to go to a rental house 100 times.
Yeah.
You go rent.
Right.
Yeah, it's just like, that was something I was not ready to do.
Yeah.
So I just went ahead and purchased, and I use it for, I'm shooting a commercial for a winery in February, so, you know, I'm still using it.
Hmm.
And, you know, I can tell you my next project I'm going to be, I'll be shooting on film. I struck a deal with Kodak. The actual president of Kodak was at one of the screenings of Hired Gun in Los Angeles and approached me and asked me why I didn't shoot it on film. I'm like, well, because it would have cost $17 million. Cause it's very expensive.
I'm not Tarantino, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, he's, sat me down, told me who he was, and I almost shit my pants. I'm like, oh, wow, okay. Hmm. President of Motion Picture at Kodak, he's like, I believe you as a filmmaker. You blew me away with storytelling. I want to put you on our roster, and you're going to get film at cost. So you can now shoot on film. So I was like, okay. I'm down with that all day long because, you know, every filmmaker's dream is to shoot. I wish I could still shoot photography on film. You know, it's just not...
It's not viable.
No, like when you shoot Dolly, man, I mean, there's $1 million worth of lighting and like monitors set up everywhere. So I'm shooting this live, like right there on the spot. The, you know, people at Sony or the record labels can watch the image immediately as soon as I take it, pops up on the screen simultaneously.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, okay, you know. Keep going. So, yeah.
Gotta love tethering.
I do miss film, man. And I gotta tell you, I was one of the last people to jump on board on the digital because I was just terrified of it. I didn't know how to use it. It was something else I had to learn, you know?
Right.
But,
makes a lot of sense.
And I have a love-hate relationship with it. You know, sometimes you can't get the warmth that you like out of film, but, you know, it is what it is.
You've been a fantastic freaking guest, man. Thanks so much for doing this with us.
Thanks. Yeah, thanks for having me on, man. This is fun talking about this stuff. So I really enjoy my gig and want to keep doing it. And thanks for help promoting. And if anybody's curious, you can purchase the film too, which is what we'd really love because, you know, we get one lump sum from Netflix. We don't get any kind of royalties or residuals. It's a licensing deal.
Right.
But, you know, you can get it on Amazon Prime. You can get it on, you know, Walmart, Target, Best Buy, or whatever. And there's about an hour of bonus material that you can't get on Netflix, which is ridiculous. Like some of the, like, oh, man, when you hear, like, Jason Newsted talk about leaving Metallica and the reality of it, and he didn't sugarcoat it, man. Like I said, he and I are pretty tight, and he went full-blown, you know what I mean, and really got deep into it. And there's a guy that worked with Michael Jackson. They got screwed out of a bunch of money. Some Steve Lukather gems in there. Who else?
Nice.
The whole Q&A. I think we had 16 of the cast at South by Southwest.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, after the film, we did a Q&A with all the cast there. It was great with, you know, Kenny, Liberty, Chris Johnson, Glenn Sobel. How cool is Alice Cooper?
Oh, he was awesome. Yeah. No.
Absolutely amazing.
Well, Liberty now, DeVito, that guy blew me away. I didn't realize he was such a cool dude. Like,
well, let me tell you something. Growing up, it was Alice Cooper and Kiss before I discovered Judas Priest, okay?
You're talking my language here, man.
Alice Cooper.
We got to be the same age.
Yeah, man. Yeah, I'm 52.
I'm 50.
But okay, so I grew up on Alice Cooper. I love it to death. It's my favorite record. It's the first one I've ever owned. And when I got word that we're going to interview Alice Cooper, you talk about memorable moments. That was the one. I was tripping out.
Yeah.
And his assistant calls. He's like, okay, Alice is on his way up now. We'll be there in 2 minutes. Hmm. I was literally shaking. I was like, I'm going to stutter. I'm going to be an asshole. What am I going to do? But then he came in and put me at ease within 10 seconds. Man, he's that cool of a dude.
Right.
And it kind of sucks because when you meet your heroes, sometimes you want them to be that persona. Like, I wanted to see him walking with an axe and a sword and a dead baby, but and instead he was like this, and the same thing with, like, you know, David Ellison, man, is like a brother to me. Like, I've known him for so many years, and he's such a sweet human being.
Right.
Same thing. I love Megadeth growing up, and I'm like, who is this guy? He's an ordained minister, and he's like drives around a soccer van, loves his children.
Right.
You know, and yeah, he's just such a great dude. So yeah. I don't know. Sometimes it's good not to meet your people, you know, because right, just like, I right. want them to be that villain sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah. That's kind of where I want to, I'd love to meet Ozzy someday. It's kind of my one thing, and I'm with you here. I'm afraid to see what it would be like, you know,
right?
Ruin all my images of the Prince of Darkness, man.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, no doubt, man.
Yeah. So anyway, you know what, Fran? You know, you've been a hell of a guest, and I would really like to have you back on again down the road and talk a little bit on about some other topics, some musicians and some music. Sounds like you and I share a lot in the musical taste, anyway. Talk a little bit more about that on the music side. What do you think?
I'm down, man.
Awesome.
Yeah. I love talking music, film, everything else, you know, and, yeah, love to, but, you know, thank you for everybody out there that has watched Hired Gun, has commented on it or whatnot. It means everything to me and everybody that worked on the movie, especially, you know, I get emails and comments from the cast, you know, from Alice Cooper's camp to the Pink camp. You know, Derek St. Holmes are just like, man, you know, thanks for making this movie, because now people are paying attention, you know.
Right.
And that was the whole reason behind making this movie, was drawing attention to these guys and just telling their stories truthfully, you know. Mm-hmm. So that was a goal, and I think we achieved it, maybe even overachieved it. So I'm very happy for them. You know, I'm happy for the viewers that they get something out of it as well. And, you know, and another thing that'd be cool is if, you know, reviews are everything. So a lot of people leave reviews on that. So you can leave reviews on Amazon.com. You can leave reviews at, on Netflix as well. I think on the laptop, you go to like details and there's a place there where you can leave your comment, review or whatnot on the film.
Cool.
I didn't even know you could do that, but I'll go do it for sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah. No, it's a cool feature for sure. It, keeps everybody engaged and we want people to continue to watch the movie and give these guys support.
Cool. Yeah, absolutely. And you know what? Very well done. It was a pleasure to watch, and I can't wait to see what you got up your sleeve for the years to come.
Yeah, I mean, we're going to start production in March on a new show that I think is going to freak people out. So I'm excited to get on that.
I love being freaked out.
I do too.
I think I know what's going to be. Yeah. I think Dolly Parton and Jason Newsted are going to be touring with Seven Dust, and it's just going to be bitching.
Hey, you want to hear a crazy trivia thing? Guess who Jason Newsted played with once on an album?
One time.
Nobody will guess in a million years. Just once. Just blurt out an artist.
Garth Brooks, Britney Spears,
Tina Turner.
Oh, get the fuck out! Really?
He played on a Tina Turner album. Yep.
Wow. Yep. Okay, you're right. I wouldn't have guessed that.
No.
Yeah, well, yeah, the life of a hired gun, man. A lot of these guys play on stuff you never can imagine. Crazy. So.
Amazing.
Pretty neat.
All right, Fran, thanks again, man. You've been amazing. Was there anything that we didn't touch on that you wanted to touch on today?
I don't think so. I think we covered a good bit of ground there. And then, just thank you, everybody, for the support.
Yeah, you bet.
The gentleman on the phone is Fran Strine. The movie is Hired Gun, and I highly recommend it from all of us at Honest Brutality. Honestly, go out, see this thing, get it, buy it. Fran, are there physical copies available as well?
There are. You can go to any of your online outlets and get it on Amazon Prime if you have that, or Amazon.com, awesome. BestBuy.com, Walmart, Target, any of your places that sell physical copies, you can go on there and order it. Like, there's abundance of behind-the-scenes material in there, like an hour's worth. Phil X jam on there with his band, The Drills. Great Q&A from South by Southwest, and a ton of interviews that are that were left on the cutting room floor that gutted me. So I made sure they made this cut.
Awesome.
Cool, man.
Well, we're looking forward to whatever you do in the future and for the continued success of Hired Gun. Thanks again, Fran, for doing the show.
Thanks, guys.
Wow.
Yeah.
Something tells me we can sit on the phone for 24 hours with this guy.
Yeah.
Oh,
and not
yeah.
hear half of what he had to share.
Super cool dude.
Yeah.
And what an amazing
fun, movie. Man. Yeah. Fun.
And what a crazy cool career. I love this stuff that is not necessarily the musicians, you know, right. the roadies, mm-hmm. the photographers, the yeah. sound guys, yeah. the behind the curtain stuff. Mm-hmm. Just I find it fascinating.
Yeah, he got into some things there. And if you see Hired Gun, you'll know what we're referring to. But he was talking about Rudy Sarzo and mm-hmm. the Randy Rhoads incident.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I'm getting a little... It bothers me to this day. It kills yeah. me. You guys know how big a Randy Rhoads right. fan I am.
Oh, yeah.
And when they brought that to light on the movie
yeah.
and seeing how it affected the guys that were actually there, like Rudy Sarzo, and the way it had mm-hmm. the impact it had on him.
Well, and to hear how deeply it would have affected yeah. Ozzy had oh, he not continued the tour.
Exactly.
You know, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
yeah.
And to see all that, just
it's pretty amazing.
It's powerful. Yeah. Man. It's powerful. Absolutely. It's great stuff. Great stuff.
Well, thanks again to Fran Strine. The movie is Hired Gun. Go check it out, ladies and gentlemen. This is Honest Brutality. You can check us out on all of our socials. We're on the Facebook, the Twitter, the Instagram. We are also at honestbrutality.com. All things Honest Brutality all of the time. We have two shows on Rock Rage Radio you can check out. Is there anything I forgot, you guys?
Only the most important fucking thing.
What's that, buddy?
You got to
stay metal!
Stay metal.